May I have your attention and invite you all to take your seats. I'd like to welcome you to this first breakout session on economic growth. We have distinguished four papers. The paper presenters would be Professor Mushtaq Khan of the School of Oriental and African Studies, University of London. We have Mr. Bishnu Pada Biswas, Deputy General Manager, Research Department, Bangladesh Bank. We have Mr. S.M. Abdullah, Assistant Professor, Department of Economics, University of Dhaka. And then we have a paper by Mr. Muhammad Abdul Khaleque, Assistant Professor, Department of Development Studies, University of Dhaka. We have two distinguished discussants, Dr. Hossain Zillur Rahman, Executive Director, PPRC, and Dr. Monzur, Senior Research Fellow, BIDS. And of course, we have a special guest, Dr. Biru Paksha Paul, who is the Chief Economist of the Bangladesh Bank. Before I start the session, let me, I've been requested by the presenters to, by the organizers to announce some rules of the game for this session. I'm told we have a max of 2 hours, which basically means roughly 10 minutes before two, we have to stop the process. Given that, the rules that have been asked to let you know in the interest of full transparency, which is that four presenters, 13 minutes each, that gives you 52 minutes. There's also a system for keeping a tab on the time. So when 10 minutes are gone, there will be a signal. And essentially after 13 minutes, the signal will say you have 0 minutes left. I hope we can be efficient and we don't need to be reminded by the timekeeper. Each discussant will roughly have about 10 minutes to present their comments on the presentations. And then we have an open discussion, hopefully by 15 to 20 minutes. The presenters will also get about 2 minutes time to respond. I guess most of the response will have to be offline. I think because the subject is so important and rich, you can't really have response in 2 minutes. But you can do it online. The chair, the distinguished special guest will also have 10 minutes, and I'll have 10 minutes, but I'll hopefully not need that 10 minutes. There's also a crest distribution after the session, so we need to conserve 2-3 minutes for that. With that, let me invite Dr. Professor Mushtaq Khan, who is very well known in Bangladesh and internationally, to present his paper on governance challenges for inclusive growth. Professor Khan.
Thank you, sir. Given the shortage of time, is this working? Is this working? Thank you. So given the shortage of time, I'm not going to stick to my slides. I will just talk and use maybe one or two diagrams from the slides, because if I use the slides, we will not finish. So the basic issue that I want to raise is research which I've done over the last 15 years on what does governance mean in developing countries. And there are basically two approaches to understanding governance. One which one can describe as the good governance approach, which is the mainstream approach which looks at criteria like property rights stability, anti-corruption, democratic accountability, rule of law. The kinds of things that we heard in the earlier session in the morning, when people think about governance, they think about those things. And the reason why economists focus on that combination of factors is based on a theories which come from new institutional economics, which suggests that those are characteristics you require to have rules-based social systems, and those rules-based social systems are important for markets to operate. Markets understood as voluntary contracting systems. Now, if you want to have a voluntary contracting system, you must have clear property rights, and you must have good contracting laws which can be enforced. If you cannot enforce contracts, then markets don't work. This is the basic idea behind the new institutional economics approach. So the idea is that if you want inclusive growth, if you want lots of new firms to set up, if you need financing for new sectors, then all of this has to be based on rules-based systems where contracting is easy, transaction costs come down, and then you will have extensive growth. The theory is fine in its own terms, but actually there are lots of flaws in the theory. And the alternative approach to this, which I have been working on and which many others have contributed to, is a conception of a developmental governance, because actually what you find in developing countries is that very few, I mean, there are no developing countries which score highly on these good governance criteria. And I'm going to show you some data very quickly on this. And the reason why countries don't score highly on the good governance criteria is that actually rules-based systems require some assumptions for them to work. The first thing you need to have a rules-based society, is that your productive sector has to be very big and generate a lot of surplus, because the cost of enforcing the rules is non-negligible. A society has to have a lot of resources to actually enforce these rules. And that comes when your economy is rather big and productive. The second problem is that a rules-based system requires that you have many powerful organizations, and all these organizations want the rules to be enforced because there is no alternative to contracting as a way of organizing production. Now, that also requires a very diversified and big society, because when you have a small productive sector, the small productive sector can get a lot of work done through informal personalized contacts. So if you have 200 firms in your country which matter, they know the politicians, they know the bureaucrats, they know how the system works. They can solve their problems through informality. Now, the problem in developing countries is that powerful organizations don't want the rules to be enforced because they prefer the rules not to be enforced. Whereas in advanced countries, powerful organizations want the rules to be enforced, and so the rules are enforced. And so, in a sense, what we are trying to do in developing countries, if you take the good governance criteria, is you are trying to enforce things which the powerful groups don't want to be enforced. And then you say, can we increase the enforcement capacity to enforce these things? And this is a hopeless task. So actually, when you look at developing countries which succeed, you find that they haven't succeeded through good governance. They have succeeded through something else. Governance, but a whole set of other governance characteristics which don't fall into the category of good governance. And when you look at those governance characteristics, you find a very complex story, because what countries can do depends on their initial political conditions and the organization of their politics, which I call the political settlement. So we don't have time to go into all that, but I just want to show you some quick figures, which, let me go to the data. This is the World Bank's own data from the World Governance Indicators. If you, and so this is an aggregation of all the good governance characteristics: property rights, rule of law, anti-corruption, democratic account. If you look at the horizontal axis, the further to the right you go, the better you score on good governance. And the vertical axis tells you the per capita income. This is a very strong relationship. Countries which score better on good governance are richer countries. The problem is, we don't know, are they rich countries because they have good governance, or do they have good governance because they're rich countries? So what we want to do is to look at whether a higher score on good governance gives you a higher growth rate, which is sustainable. That's the real question. So this is some data that I've been working on for some time, and if you then split developing into two groups, so the red dots are developing countries which are diverging. Their growth rate is lower than the advanced country average. They score poorly on governance and they have low growth. The blue countries are advanced countries, the World Bank definition of advanced countries. So they have higher scores on governance and they have a higher growth by definition, because we have selected the red countries to be lower than the average growth of the blue countries. The real question is, where are the high growth developing countries? Where are the Chinas, where are the Indias, where are the Malaysias, and so on? When you look for the converging countries, that is developing countries which have a growth rate higher than the advanced country average, you get a very surprising result. The converging countries are exactly on top of the diverging countries in terms of their governance scores. In other words, the average governance score in terms of good governance and the dispersion is the same. Which means if someone gave you the good governance score of a country and said, what will be the growth rate in the next 20 years? your answer would be, I don't know. It actually gives you no information about what your growth rate will be, and we are spending a lot of resources on something which we actually have no evidence for. Now, very good econometricians will take this data and do some rocket science on it and extract some causality. Don't trust it, because actually what you see here is noise. There's nothing there. And I was taught econometrics by very good people who said, before you run any regressions, look at the data. And if the data isn't telling you anything, there's nothing there. So this is a diagram which summarizes where the problem lies. The problem is that you have these three bunches of countries. You can draw it achievable because you are not going to get a rule of law society. So how does a China, a South Korea, or even those states in India, which are doing well, if you look at Tamil Nadu or Gujarat, how do they solve the land problem? They have agencies which have the legitimacy and the bureaucratic capacity to acquire land and transfer land to other users, and they do it in a legitimate way which has social acceptance. So it's not a question of force, it's not a question of repression, it's a question of acquiring the legitimacy to do this in a socially acceptable way, compensating people fairly and getting the political acceptance for this transition to happen. So if you have to have sustained growth for 30, 40, 50 years, you need to have these agencies. Now, if you look at the details of how South Korea, China and others did it, they did it in that way, not through efficiently working land markets. Why do investors go to Tamil Nadu and Gujarat and not to West Bengal and UP? It's because Tamil Nadu and Gujarat have agencies which solve the land problem, right? And if you go to UP or you go to Bihar or West Bengal even, you have resistance to this process because the agencies are not legitimate. And they are not legitimate for very good reason, because in the past they acquired land and instead of giving it to industry, people built houses on it and shopping malls and so on. And peasants realized that people made quick money through these land transfers. Now in Bangladesh we haven't reached that point, but there is a lot of illegitimate land transfers going on. And we are going to very soon hit a point where poor people and peasants will mobilize to block these land transfers. Before we hit that point, we have to construct the agencies and the legitimacy to do this properly. This is developmental governance. Developmental governance is not that we will, you know, digitize our land records and we will have well-working land markets. This is a pipe dream. It won't happen. Then you have lots of market failures in developing countries, particularly in the areas of building organizations and skills. If you look at successful countries, what is the main constraint in setting up new firms? New firms lack competitiveness because they don't have the organizational capabilities. This problem cannot be solved by doing business conditions or making it easier to get your permit and faster telephone connection. The problem is, even if you got your telephone connection in one day and had registered your company in one day, you are still not competitive because you don't know how to organize your production. That means you need to have some form of positive support from the state, and that positive support from the state has to come with conditions which can be enforced. So if you look at the developmental states, they had positive support from the state in many different forms, but if you failed, the support went and the company was restructured. If you look at less successful developmental states, there is support, it gets captured by rent seekers, the state cannot withdraw it, and the outcome is very poor. So again, if you look at the banking sector in Bangladesh today, you find a lot of evidence of bad loans, of scams, of huge losses of revenue, which the Bangladesh bank is struggling very hard to stop, but not succeeding at all. So this is again another area of developmental governance, which has nothing to do with general rule of law, but strengthening those financial institutions which can provide long-term cheap financing for new sectors without it being captured, and without renewing these loans to failed companies with no conditions. Finally, on political stabilization, again something raised in the morning, political stabilization does not happen through rule-following politics in any developing country. But you need a political process which is inclusive of all powerful elites, and all powerful elites must feel that through this political system they will get a fair share of rents. And this is the work that Douglas North and I and others have worked on limited access orders and political settlements. There is now a huge amount of evidence and high theory which tells you the importance of including elites in this rent game. If you don't do that, you will have political instability and explosions. And Bangladesh again has that problem that we have a political system where not all powerful elites feel that they have been included and are getting a share of rents. And this is not sustainable. And this is, I think, why we are getting these indications of capital flight and so on happening from Bangladesh, because even powerfully connected businesses now do not feel secure that there is a long-term stable future in Bangladesh. So I will stop there and ask you to think about these two different ways of thinking about governance. And I think that developmental governance is more feasible. But if you think of developmental governance, Bangladesh has huge challenges of meeting those conditions. And I think while right now we are in the converging group of countries which have high growth, the problem is this might not be a sustainable solution, and we should not rest on our laurels and think that because we are there, we will always be there. The historical experience is that countries drop frequently out of group two into group one. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Khan, for what I thought was a fascinating presentation. I think the 13 minutes does not do justice to the ideas and the analysis you bring to the table. We hope we'll find an opportunity to engage you even more with greater depth. May I suggest that you submit, share your paper with us, if it is okay. We'll really appreciate that. Okay, I have a request from Dr. Zillur Rahman, because he has to leave and he's supposed to be discussing of this paper. So given that he has a time constraint, I will suggest that he makes his comments on the paper for about 10 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think Mushtaq makes a very convincing case for his argument, and of course, I think the time constraint hasn't done justice at all for him to come to the stage where the way forward for Bangladesh and where the governance challenges are. He has hinted at some areas. I'm sure the paper, I've read the paper, and it is a very fascinating and lots of meat for thought for those who want to think about how Bangladesh can move on its next phase. In terms of giving a few comments, I have no issue at all with the theoretical framework, you know, the development governance, basically the question of unpacking governance as a factor in economic transformation, and the importance of this textbook understanding of good governance to operational understanding of developmental governance. I think that's a now around the world also well understood sort of progress. In the context of Bangladesh, Mushtaq at the end hinted a little, but the two options of good governance and development governance are not just instrumental options in front of us. I think what I read his paper is that development governance is also underpinned by a political reality. So it's not like a bureaucrat has, you know, which governance path I'll follow. Shall I follow good governance or shall I follow development? That's not the real choice. Development governance in that sense is hinting at a different type of political process which has to underpin that. Otherwise, the bureaucrat in UP and the bureaucrat in Tamil Nadu are both from Indian Civil Service. They could both have followed the choices, but they don't, because the political organization of power within those states are actually differently structured. So we have to, if you want to pursue this argument, then we have to really have a sort of larger look at the background political reality which shapes this governance choices. And for the Bangladesh context, I would really, you know, given the paucity of time, I would not really try to go for any in-depth comment, etc. But also reflecting on the morning session, reflects on some puzzles. You know, Bangladesh, we have been trying to understand puzzles, Bangladesh change through posing puzzles. You know, in the 90s, we posed the puzzle of the Bangladesh paradox. Why there was growth despite at that time shortfalls in the good governance agenda. I think the puzzle in 2016 for me is the following. At one level, there is great political stability. The government of the day has, in a way, sort of neutralized or basically managed political protest. So there is no overt capacity for protest within society. That's a political reality which has been created. So there is political stability. But the puzzle is, the political stability comes also with political uncertainty. The stability is a current description. Uncertainty is about the future. And where does the two link up? It's in Mushtaq's paper, it's there. It's on private investment. I mean, you just pick out one economic data. That data reflects this problem of uncertainty. If the stability we see should have spurred private investment, but up post 2012, I think the data is showing that private investment is stagnant. So I think this is the puzzle we have to dwell on. There is stability, but uncertainty about the future. And the investors are keeping their money under the pillows rather than, you know, going out and creating those enterprises which will produce jobs, etc., etc. So this is one puzzle we need to reflect. And I think the answers are not too difficult to find out, because the question then is the process through which stability has been attained. That itself perhaps is generating those uncertainties. You can achieve stability through a variety of processes, through social endorsement, through sort of legitimacy creating initiatives, which basically brings everyone on board and, you know, imparts that sense of certainty about the future. But the process of stability which is currently we are witnessing in Bangladesh has been achieved through processes which are exclusionary, which are not inclusive in terms of political participation, which are perhaps built on certain types of corruption processes which negate the developmental governance that Mushtaq talked about. So we have stability, but created through process which is generating uncertainty, and therefore that uncertainty is reflecting in the economic reality in the sense of private investment in stagnation. And of course, if anyone thinks that public investment will replace private investment as the driver in Bangladesh, that's really not a viable idea to think about. And even there are question marks on the small rise in public investment that we have witnessed in recent times, in the sense that underlying cost, unjustified cost escalations have really expanded the apparent nominal size of the public investment. So this is one puzzle, and I'll finish with just another puzzle, is that, you know, the title is Way Towards Middle Income Country. And as we understood, that this, such a title is not sufficiently instructive of trying to find the real answers, because as you understood, we are already a middle income country by the textbook definition. The point is, we are in a certain growth phase. Can we move to another growth phase? That's the sort of way we need to frame this question. And I think there is an issue that Bangladesh and in Mushtaq's framework, one point which I would say that in particularly in institutional economics, one area where there is one deficiency which I see, which is that the agency of the people is not sufficiently incorporated within the overall framework, but that's a discussion we can have separately actually. But in the Bangladesh context, the 6% growth rate, which has become like even the rickshawwala can also be talking in these terms, 6% growth rate is a term which has percolated down to the popular. What does it indicate? And I think our understanding for, as economists, it's incumbent upon us to explain what does 6% indicate. Does it indicate a sort of growth stagnation, because this has been around for almost a decade? Or is it the stepping stone to acceleration? So I think Bangladesh, I would not use the word stagnation here actually, because I would say that Bangladesh has achieved economic resilience. Therefore, Bangladesh is unlikely to experience the reverses that Pakistan experienced, where it dropped to actually 2-3%. Bangladesh is, if you look at the economic census 2013 and the demographic dividend as we discussed, there is a sort of a low productivity expansion of economic activities which will continue to ensure that there is resilience. Around 5-6% growth will happen. But the real challenge for Bangladesh is growth acceleration. And that's where I think the whole discussion about development, governance, etc. happen. Can the current dispensation of governance and the political reality which underpins it, is it supportive of the acceleration of growth, which is the real challenge for Bangladesh? Resilience has been proved. Resilience is here to stay. But acceleration is the challenge. And on that, I think we have to really dwell. And I think Mushtaq has hinted, I would also agree with him, that the current reality where there is stability combined with uncertainty poses huge question mark on the likelihood of achieving growth acceleration. But it will, overall context of Bangladesh, will continue to indicate that resilience will remain a feature of our economic trend in the next, in the coming years. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Excellent papers always invite excellent comments, so I'm really appreciative of this dialogue, which must continue, by the way, Prof. Mushtaq. I think both you and he has raised some very major, I would say, development questions about political economy issues. We deserve a lot more discussion. Let me now invite Mr. Bishnu Biswas to make his paper. His title is Relationship Between Inflation and Economic Growth, Determining the Threshold Level of Inflation in Bangladesh. Honorable Chair, Dr. Sadiq Ahmed, Vice Chairman of PRI, Honorable Special Guest, Dr. Biru, Chief Economist of Bangladesh Bank, Honorable Discussants, Dr. Hossain, Zillur, Rahman, already gone, and Dr. Monzur, Hossain, Senior Research Fellow, BIDS, and distinguished participant, good morning to all. I am very glad to be here to present the paper entitled Relationship Between Inflation and Economic Growth, Determining the Threshold Level of Inflation in Bangladesh. At first, outline. We have outlined the study paper in the following sections. At first, introduction, literature review of objectives, historical trends, methodology, empirical results, concluding remarks, and policy implications. Introduction. The topic is widely discussed and debatable issue in both theoretical and empirical findings. The debate
Brits from two main schools of economic thought, that is structuralist and monetarist. The structuralists hold the view that inflation is essential for economic growth, that is positive relationship, whereas the monetarists think inflation as detrimental to economic progress, that is negative relationship. There is another relationship which is non-linear, that is positive when inflation is low but negative for high inflation. However, inflation may affect investment, which can affect growth. Higher inflation has a negative impact on private investment in manufacturing. That is why optimal growth can be achieved by controlling inflation and side by side raising private investment. Let us review. There are so many authors who conducted studies on this topic: Biru, Fisher, Bruno Sterli, Sarrell, Ghosh and Phillips, Mullik and Chaudhary, Khanan Shenadji. A very few studies have also been conducted in Bangladesh on relationship between inflation and growth. Here it is noted that we have taken the method from Sarrell using annual data from 1970 to 1990 for 87 countries. Sarrell found that the threshold level is at 8%, below which is the effect of inflation on growth is negligible or slightly positive, but beyond 8%, there is a significant, extremely powerful and robust negative effect on economic growth. A very few studies from Bangladesh: Ahmed, Murtaza, Hayat, Yunus. Ahmed Murtaza showed a statistically significant long-run negative relationship as well as a threshold level of 6% inflation for Bangladesh. Hayat showed that the threshold level is about 5.5%. Yunus demonstrates that relationship between inflation and growth is non-linear, with the existence of a threshold level of inflation within the range of 7 to 8%. Objectives. The main objectives of our study are to examine the inflation growth nexus empirically in Bangladesh using annual data for the period of FY 1977 to FY 2015. Next objective is to find out the threshold level of inflation rate for Bangladesh economy. And last one is to cushion efficient and effective policy recommendations for future actions. Historical trends of inflation and economic growth in Bangladesh. In chart 1, we observe the movements in economic growth and inflation in different decades of Bangladesh economy during the period FY 1977 to 2015. After liberation to 1980, GDP growth and inflation rates abnormally fluctuated. That's why we explored mainly the data of inflation and GDP growth in Bangladesh for 1981 to 2015. It is visual evidence that during 80s growth inflation gap was so high and higher inflation rate remained detrimental to economic growth. The decade average inflation rate depicted 10.27%, whereas the average GDP growth was 4.01% during 1981 to 1990. Same way, during 1991 to 2000, the decade average inflation rate went down significantly to 5.54%, which was about half of the previous decade, and the GDP growth surged moderately to 4.8%. Afterwards, the decade average GDP growth recorded at 5.82%. Side by side, the decade average CPI inflation also documented at 6.25% during 2001 to 2010. Data of current decade, though it is not completed, show that the average CPI inflation stood at 8.43% and real GDP growth is 6.27%. GDP growth inflation relationship. Using historical data, we have formed five levels here. The first level shows when inflation rate is ranging from 0 to 3%, average GDP growth rate is 4.4%. As inflation is appeared to the range of above 3 to 5%, and above 5 to 7%, then GDP growth rate went up gradually to 5.25% and 5.74% respectively. However, fourth and fifth levels show gradual decrease in average GDP growth, that is 5.13% and 4.37% respectively, which indicate the negative relationship between inflation and GDP growth rate. It is clear from the above observation that when inflation is at third level, average GDP growth is at the highest level, that means 5.74%. Relationship between GDP growth and inflation in Bangladesh through scatter diagram. The scatter diagram depicts inflation rate and its corresponding real GDP growth from the above chart in nonlinear relationship between inflation and GDP growth rate. The threshold level of inflation is observed, which is between 6 to 7%. Methodology and model specification. As you have two main objectives of our study, we have considered two models to find out the relationship and threshold level of inflation. First one is simple model, which is to identify the overall impact of inflation on GDP growth. Here the coefficient beta 1 is expected to be positive or negative. The second one is threshold model, which is developed by Sarrell in 1996. Sarrell considered the impact of extra inflation beyond the threshold level in addition to overall impact of inflation on growth. In this model, beta 1 is expected to be positive and beta 2 is expected to be negative. But the sum of both coefficients must be negative. We calculate this regression equation in iterative process, assuming structural break between 4 to 7%. We also consider quadratic regression model for finding threshold level of inflation. In quadratic model, beta 1 is expected to be positive and beta 2 is expected to be negative. Empirical results. Simple model. In simple regression model, we found that beta 1 is negative and significant minus 0.16, which is indicating negative relationship between GDP growth and inflation. Threshold model is two-part, Sarrell method and quadratic method. In Sarrell model, we found beta 1 is positive 0.42 and beta 2 is negative minus 0.81. And the sum of both coefficient is negative minus 0.39. Therefore, the model shows a non-linear relationship and optimum threshold level of inflation, which is 6.2%. Threshold detection. The graph shows that how the threshold level of inflation is obtained. The figure depicts the value of residual sum of squares against different level of threshold, 4 to 7%. We have selected optimum threshold level 6.25%, whereas the value of residual sum of square is minimum 53.71. Empirical results, threshold model. Quadratic model. In this quadratic model, beta 1 is positive, that is 0.50, and beta 2 is negative, minus 0.04. The estimated quadratic equation satisfied both conditions for maximization, and we got similar threshold level. We have also done diagnostic test, first order condition, second order condition, and at last, optimal rate of inflation, which is 6.25. Empirical findings. We have observed two important findings. Non-linear relationship, growth is positive when inflation is lower, but it is negative for higher inflation. The estimated threshold level of inflation is at 6.25%. It is noted that the estimated threshold level of inflation is very close to the budgetary targeted level of inflation, 6.2%, for FY 2015-16. Another important point is that Bangladesh Bank's forecast is 6.1% inflation in the monetary policy for January to June 2016. Concluding remarks and policy implications. Sustainable growth GDP needs macroeconomic stability, lower inflation, and higher investment. Controlling price level below the threshold level through monetary policies needed to tame inflation, policy tightening through complementary mix of monetary and fiscal policies recommended. Keeping inflation at a tolerable level to achieve the optimum economic growth is required. Rational target of inflation must be set. Thank you very much. Thank you all.
Thank you, Bishnu, for being so efficient in presenting your very well thought out research. I am sure it will invite a lot of comments and discussion. I will now turn to the third presentation by Mr. S.M. Abdullah. The topic of his presentation is Consequences of Interactive Effect of Exchange Rate Volatility on Trade and GDP Growth.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, for giving me the opportunity. I would like to welcome you all to my presentation, which is on consequence of interactive effect of exchange rate volatility and trade on economic growth. No matter with what kind of trade, what kind of growth theory we are talking about, doesn't matter whether it's endogenous growth or exogenous growth model. Exchange rate has never been the center variable for analyzing the economic growth. But as we know that countries are becoming day by day interlinked, and they're dependent on each other for different kinds of commodities. So countries are becoming together for the trade dependence. So since trade is an important part, and trade is also an important part for the growth of the country, so exchange rate is an important macroeconomic variable which can determine the competitiveness of a country. So from that point of view, and also there are some other channels following which exchange rate can be actually a very important variable for determining the economic growth. For example, there is at least three important channels for which exchange rate is important. One could be trade, one could be financial development, and one could be investment. So following these three particular channels, an exchange rate of a country can be very much important for determining the economic growth. So the main research question for my paper is, what is the impact of exchange rate volatility on economic growth, and does its interaction with international trade make the impact worse? So if we just like to have experience of what's going on in this field, actually there is not that much study which has come up with some concrete conclusion about the impact of exchange rate volatility on economic growth. So most of the studies they actually come up with some mixed results. Some studies have found ambiguous results, and also there are some studies which doesn't have any clear cut conclusion about the impact of exchange rate volatility on economic growth. Here I have some summary of studies. You can see that Bailu and Lefrance and Fernald during 2003, they have used 60 countries, and they have studied all these countries from 1973 to 1998 and use a dynamic generalized method of movement estimation, and they have found a positive impact of exchange rate volatility on economic growth. While Janus and Crichton during 2015, they have used OECD countries, and they have studied the countries for 1980 to 2001. They also have used a panel data estimation, but they have found a negative relationship. Similarly, there is a lot of other studies. Most of the studies have used panel data models, and they have used both positive negative relationships, and some of the studies doesn't have any strong conclusion. The main pioneer in this field should be Professor Agian, who is a Harvard professor who published a paper during 2009, and he has used 83 countries and studied the countries from 1960 to 2000, and by using a generalized method of movement, he has found the relationship between exchange rate volatility and economic growth given conditioning on financial development of the country. So he is actually the first person who have tried not only to watch the relationship between exchange rate and volatility, exchange rate volatility and growth in a pure setup. He also have allowed some other channels to interact with exchange rate volatility, and the particular channel was basically financial development. And most of the studies in this field actually covered the areas from sub-Saharan Africa, OECD countries, or from European part, but there was not that much study found before 2013 which were actually focused on the Asian economies. And Very recently, in 2013, by Professor Karan Bikram, they have used 18 Asian countries and studied them from 1961 to 2006, and they have found positive relationship and also some kind of independent effect of exchange rate volatility on GDP growth rate. So this could be the first study for actually just checking the relationship between exchange rate volatility and economic growth, focusing on the Asian countries. Now, the main motivation for my work is actually, if you just look on the relation, if you just try to see what's going on in this field, focusing on the Asian countries, we see that the number of works is very low. And also, if you allow the exchange rate volatility to interact with an important channel, which we already have mentioned, that is trade, then the number of study will become even smaller. So that's where the motivation lies. Now, the main hypothesis of the study is the exchange rate volatility actually can contain a negative impact on GDP growth rate. And if you allow the exchange rate volatility to interact with GDP growth, then the negative impact will become more negative. So the main panel data model or the growth regression that we have estimated here is actually presented in front of you. The main two coefficients that we would like to check here is the alpha 1 and alpha 2. Alpha 1 is attached with log of volatility of real exchange rate, and alpha 2 is basically the coefficient with the interactive term. So having read the all literatures, we can have three different scenarios on the basis of the values of this alpha 1 and alpha 2. So if both the coefficient becomes negative, then the overall impact of log of volatility of real log of volatility of real exchange rate on GDP growth rate will be negative. And if alpha 1 and alpha 2 does contain some contradictory signs with each other, then you will find a threshold level of trade GDP ratio. Now, the data was actually collected from three different sources using International Financial Statistics Database, World Development Indicator, and PEN World Table. And the main variable, which was exchange rate, this exchange rate was collected from IFS database, and the observations were actually daily. So we have used here almost eight countries, in total eight countries from the Asia, and all the countries were actually observed from 1985 to 2013. So the panel was eight countries, and the time dimension was for 29 years. Now, because since we have a panel data, and in recent times, one of the most burning issue. With a burning issue is when a person deals with panel data is the cross-section dependence, because the countries are becoming dependent on one dependence with one another. So that's why we just have to first check whether there is cross-section dependence, and in order to check the cross-section dependence, we have used four different tests, and each test basically tested whether the error terms of the panel regression is contemporaneously correlated or not. And if we found that there is cross-section dependence, in that case, the available panel unit truth test is not actually readily applicable, because in that case, you have to demean the data and use the panel unit test. So we have actually first tested whether there is cross-section dependence, and then we have applied the IPS panel unit rate test. So the most important part is how to construct the volatility. Here actually we have used two different methods to construct the volatility of log of volatility of real exchange rate. First, we use a conditional heteroscedasticity model, which we call GARTS 1-1 model, and then we relax the assumption of conditionality from go to the unconditional measurement of volatility, which is the simple standard deviation of real exchange rate. And real exchange rate here is actually CPI weighted nominal exchange rate. So we have collected nominal exchange rate for each country and convert it with respect to the US dollar, and then multiply the nominal exchange rate with respect to the ratio of consumer price index of the two countries. Now, when we try to apply the conditional heteroscedastic model, the first step is actually to test whether there is any arch effect in the data. I mean, whether there is volatility clustering or not. So for all these eight countries, we have tried to test this arch effect, and we have seen that Except India, for other seven countries, we have detected the arch effect. That means there was volatility clustering in the real exchange rate series. So if we have a look on the graph, we can see that for all the countries, there is some high volatility periods of real exchange rate, which is followed by high volatility periods, and there is some low volatility periods of real exchange rate, which is also followed by the low volatility periods. That means there is volatility clustering. It actually justifies that we can apply GUTS 1-1 model to extract the volatility for these particular countries. And here I would like to mention that GUTS 1-1 model is widely used to extract conditional volatility, because there is a study from Hansen and Lund, which is published in 2005 in Journal of Applied Econometrics. There they have tried 330 different conditional heteroscedastic model, and they have found that GUTS 1-1 beats everyone. So we can apply GUTS 1-1 model. So after applying GUTS 1-1 model, we have extracted the volatility series. Now, before applying the unit truth test in panel setting, we would like to present our cross-sectional dependence test result. It's clear from the table that except only one variable, I think the variable is employment growth, all the variables have been found to be actually cross-sectional dependent on each other. Since the variables are actually cross-sectionally dependent, it's really, really important to address this issue before applying the unit truth or stationarity test results. So since the variables were found cross-sectional dependent, we have decided to demean the variable and apply the IPS panel unit truth, because all the existing unit truth tests are not applicable if your data is cross-sectionally dependent. And when you have a cross-sectional dependent data, if you would like to apply a panel unit truth test, in that case, of course, the first step is we need to demean the data. So we have demeaned the data and applied the IPS panel unit truth test. In the test results, we have seen that almost all the variables are I0, but there are two most important variables. One is gross fixed capital formation, and the other one is trade, which were I1. Since the integrated order of the all variables were not same, we haven't been able to do any co-integration analysis or any long-run kind of analysis. So the main option could be to go for kind of fixed effect model or for any kind of random effect model. In order to identify which model would be more appropriate, we have used a kind of both way testing procedure. First, we have applied a Hossain model specification test, which gives us the result that the fixed effect model would be more appropriate. Then we also have tried a likelihood ratio test, which actually tests whether the fixed effect model that we have used is appropriate or not. In the both test result, we have found that the fixed effect model would be more appropriate. Then we have tried to estimate the coefficients of all these models, coefficient of all these variables using six different models, where models have been differentiated with respect to the fixed effect estimation. Now, it's clear from the table that in all the models, the coefficient of the variable log of volatility of RER, that is the alpha 1 is negative, and also the coefficient alpha 2, which was basically the interaction between log of volatility of RER and the trade GDP ratio, that is also negative. So it means that if we allow the volatility of real effective exchange rate to interact with trade GDP ratio, then the effect will be basically worse. And the higher the trade GDP ratio of a country, and the higher the volatility of real effective exchange rate, the GDP will be actually more affected. Now, after that, we have tried to just estimate the model in a dynamic way. So in the dynamic model, we also have found the same results. Then we have tried to check the robustness of our results. In order to find the robustness of our result, we have changed the definition of the volatility from the conditional perspective to the unconditional one, where we have used the simple standard deviation of real effective exchange rate. And you can see the results clearly that in this definition of the log of volatility of real effective exchange rate, all the coefficients are still negative. So it's almost established that no matter what kind of definition of log of volatility of effective exchange rate you are using, the effect of real effective exchange rate is going to be negative, and it's going to be more negative if you have a higher trade GDP ratio. So the question is, what will be our choice? Should we go for the flexible exchange rate, or should we go for the fixed exchange rate? Of course, flexible exchange rate is important, because if we have a flexible exchange rate, then the country can adjust quickly with the financial market, and of course everything can be more smooth. So it's important to have flexible exchange rate, but how flexible is good enough? So since for Bangladesh, we know that nowadays we are becoming from a aid dependent to a trade dependent country, and trade dependency ratio of the country is going very, very high nowadays. So we should keep in mind that when we allow the Dhaka against dollar to appreciate or even to depreciate, we have to keep it in a very, very tolerable band. Otherwise, if the band exceeds, in that case, of course, through following trade GDP ratio channel, the GDP of the country is going to be affected. Thank you so much for the concentration.
Thank you, Abdullah, for sharing your well thought out research on a very important subject, which I'm sure will be of interest to Bangladesh Bank and to other researchers. Let me now invite Mr. Muhammad Abdul Khaleque to present his paper. He's talking about economic growth forecast in 2021.
February ভাষা মাস আগামী কাল ভাষা দিবস তো সকল ভাষা শহীদদের প্রতি শ্রদ্ধা জানিয়ে আমি আজকের প্রেজেন্টেশন শুরু করছি. Thanks to Mr. Chair, much thanks to special guest and thanks to the presenters. I feel proud to present here on the topics economic growth forecast in 2021. My presentation will briefly discuss on economic transformations and transitions and broadly cover on the issues of economic growth forecast using the simple growth estimation techniques to the sophisticated growth forecasting techniques like unobserved component models. And the estimations has been done using the data from 1991 to till date. So if you look at the simple trend of economic growth, we'll find some interesting findings of the trend of economic growth in Bangladesh. If you look at 1991, we see the real GDP growth was only 3.34%, and that has increased to 5.04% in 1992 and 91 to 92. And then if you look at there is a two successive decline in economic growth, and that is from 5.04 to 4.57% to 4.08%. And again, the economic growth has increased by one. And this relationship shows that your economic behavior is showing an interesting pattern. If you gain a 1 year economic growth, but you will lose in economic growth by two successive years. On an average, you will see these interesting patterns prevails up to now. And the economic growth discussions has attained interesting discussions topics in the recent years, because the Bangladesh economy has attained economic growth over 6% at least in the last four fiscal years. So we have seen with the growth of GDP, along with the population growth has declined over time from 2.2% to 1.3%, and whereas the per capita GDP has gone up from 1.5% to 5.0%. And the growth of per capita GDP was due to primarily the increased growth in economic growth and lower growth in population growth. And we have seen this higher economic growth has been achieved due to the investment structures, auspicious export volumes, and remittance inflow in the country. And the higher economic growth has contributed in expected life expectancy, poverty reductions, and food security of the country. And the economy in meantime has transformed from the main agricultural sectors to the industry sector and the service sector. And the earlier, the major contributions has come from the agricultural sector, but recently these the contributions of the industry sector has been increasing, and the major contribution is coming from the manufacturing sector. And already you know the Bangladesh economy has got a resilience, and the inflation has been correctly monitored and managed. So with this auspicious growth scenario, Bangladesh is liking to be a middle income country. Although the country has achieved the lower middle income country, but aims to get the lower middle income countries by the 2021. And set the growth targets of the three major sectors, especially the industry sector, will expect it to grow at 12% by 2021, and whereas agriculture is assumed to grow at 4.5%. And it was predicted that the industry will contribute around one third of the GDP by 2021. That means we will transform from the agricultural economy based economy to industry based economy. So although we have attained the lower middle income country based on the economic condition only, but the other conditions, at least the development indicators like human asset and economic vulnerability situation, has to also be attained to get the middle income country status by 2021. So this is the question. So can we really reach the middle income country by 2021? We have estimated the years beyond 2021 to be the middle income country using the assumed growth rate. And if we see the assumed or predicted growth rates in the our perspective plans and 7-6 plans, we find the country is expecting the growth rate will be over 10%, or near to 10%. But we have seen that in the trend analysis, so our GDP is more or less constant at around 6%. And if this 6% prevails in the next 5 years, we can attain the middle income country status by at least 2027. And if the country can attain the high economic growth over 9%, then the country can achieve the middle income country status by 2024. So these estimations was based on the growth assumed growth scenarios, and the growth has been predicted using several simple techniques to sophisticated techniques as well. So I have examined the data using the business cycle pattern and estimated two boundary models, the upper boundary models and lower boundary models, as well as I have used the models, unobserved component models, to estimate or predict the GDP variables. So what we have seen in our data, if we consider the up and down case of the economic behavior of the GDP, we find that in 2014, the economic growth could be actually 6.93%. And considering the ups and downs, we can reach to the GDP rate of 6.7% by 2021. And the two models, the upper boundary models and the lower boundary models, shows that the upper boundary model actually shows the over optimistic scenarios of the GDP growth that says that by 2021 we can achieve a higher growth of 9.25%. But the lower boundary models, which is basically a pessimistic view of economic growth, shows that the GDP can be achieved at 7.5% around. But the linear predictions of the data shows that we can achieve a growth of 7.44%. And if we form a linear combinations of the upper boundary models and lower boundary models of the GDP growth, we find that economic growth lies in between 7.45 to 9.25%. Monzur has estimated forecasted the GDP growth based on the 5-year moving average and shown that the country can achieve a GDP growth of over 9.3% in the decades 2025 to 2030, and that was actually 9.4% from 2020 to 2025. Whereas the previous, using the simple linear trend analysis, estimated that the GDP will grow at 10% by 2021. And the GDP growth has shown an interesting pattern as well. So if we look at our data, we'll find that the GDP generally goes down during the national election years, and then it goes up again. And if we find that our GDP is growing increasing rate at the before 2010, but after 2010 it has shown a slower rate. That means could be the GDP growth is going down, stagnant. But if we assume that our mega development projects like the and super infrastructure projects completed by the targeted period, then the country can achieve an average growth rate of 8 to 9%. And if Bangladesh becomes becomes optimistic, we can achieve at least 8 to 9% GDP by 2021. Here I will say some limitations of my studies. Although my studies is primarily in invariant analysis, and mostly lack of dynamic and component of the macroeconomic analysis, and that is partly done by Abdullah and Mrs. Bishnu. I hope Bangladesh, I will say in a sentence, that Bangladesh can achieve 8 to 9% growth rate if the country can achieve the mega project completions. Okay, so I'll like to thank to chair, and like to thank to all the presenters, and like to thank to SANEM for giving us the excellent opportunities to present us here. So thank you, everybody.
And he has left. So I assume that Dr. Monzur said you're going to talk about all four papers, you're going to focus on three or the later three papers. So in some sense, Mushtaq, you'll have to wait for the audience to tell you more questions on that. So let's
10 minutes.
Okay, so that will give us chance to have a bigger discussion from the participants. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I'll try to give my comments in 10 minutes. First of all, I would like to congratulate our young authors for their hard work and for their papers. I want to start with the middle one, exchange rate paper, as it is my priority of interest, and I think the author will be helpful, will be benefited from our comments. I will try to give my comments from academic point of view, particularly to help the paper authors so that they can publish these papers in a more improved way in a good journal. I have few questions on the exchange rate paper. First of all, about the choice of countries. What was the basis of choice of these 8 countries? The author should clarify this. Why some East Asian countries, and including Bangladesh and India maybe? So this is an important issue that others might ask you. And the second issue is some of issues you have mentioned in the paper in your presentation, which I think a bit in a slightest statement you made. For example, you said that not enough studies on Asian countries have been done before, and you already included Southeast Asian countries in the sample. As you know that East Asian crisis generated a lot of paper in the 1990s and subsequent periods. And most of the paper's theme was on exchange rate volatility, exchange rate appreciation issues, over-valuations, and many other choice of regimes and others. And I am also surprised to see that none of my papers have been cited here, although I have written a few papers and published in good journals. So this is one issue. I think you should not say like this, that this is, I think in a way I said that the literature review was not adequate in a sense. And another issue is, you already mentioned, but I haven't seen the reflection of these in the paper, that you said that as you mentioned, I also reiterated, exchange rate is a macroeconomic variable, but it doesn't have direct effect on growth. It comes through channels of growth. For example, you mentioned that trade is one of the channels, transmission channels. Another one could be capital flows. And third one could be macroeconomic stability, in the sense that inflation and other things. If you don't take this into account in your paper and it directly do some regression and others to show the relationship between growth and exchange rate volatility, it might be misleading. So you have to discuss a bit more about the transmission channels and their impact of exchange rate on those, then it might be more meaningful. And another, in that sense, the research question you asked, I think a bit misleading. You said that what is the impact of exchange rate volatility on economic growth, and does it interact with international trade, make the impact worse? Usually it interacts with international trade, and then it comes to the growth. So I think I would request you to reformulate your research question in that way. And again, the question, and it is a debate in the literature, that volatility, some papers say it is good for the economy, some say it is bad for the economy. There is again a question of threshold there, whether excessive volatility or it is a moderate volatility, and you have to define this way. So these are my main questions to you to improve the paper. And also persistence is another issue you should look into. And the final conclusion of the paper doesn't come from the analysis. You should be careful about this. You should not come all on a sudden to Bangladesh. You are talking about a group of countries, and then your conclusion should be based on your findings. That would improve your paper a lot. With this, I want to come to the first paper, Inflation Threshold. Mr. Bishnu Padovishas, he already mentioned that a few papers already done on this, and then I ask him why he did it again. This is an important question he has to answer. And why his threshold is better than or realistic than others. What kind of improvement he made in his paper. So these are the academic questions he has to resolve before making a good paper. And again, I would say that this is a very simplistic analysis you have done in your paper, just to regress inflation on growth, and without considering a structural bar model or using threshold or regressive regression. Those are the conventional methods that we have used in analyzing the threshold. Analyzing threshold definitely is an important issue for the policymakers, particularly for the central bank and other policymakers. But there is a note of caution that you have to be very careful about this. For example, in Bangladesh, before 1980s, inflation was very high, growth was low. In 1990s, inflation was low and growth was higher. And in the late 2000s, you will see that inflation was higher, growth is higher. So how can you reconcile all these things? So one threshold may not be enough to say all those stories of the growth. So there might have some multiple thresholds, multiple equilibria in the economy, and as well as multiple breaks. So it is important to have this kind of things in the paper to make it a good paper. And third one, I would say that growth forecast is a very smart analysis, but this is a kind of mathematical exercise without taking into account of the total macroeconomic framework. So without having macroeconometric framework of various building blocks of the economy, if you just look into the growth variations and add this to project the future one, then I would say that it will not be a good exercise for economists or for the economy. So it would be useful if you bring it in a total macroeconomic framework, which is a conventional, and then I think it will get some get some attention of the authors and researchers. Thank you.
Thank you, Monzur, for your very thoughtful advice, constructive advice, I would say, to the young researchers. I think some more advice will come from the discussion. We have been doing very well on time, so I'm glad that you can allow a greater participation, including from the, I think, from the table also, if they want to talk about each other's paper, that should be fine. But I'll first turn to the audience and ask them, please identify yourself and ask the question directly to the subject that you want to raise, and please be brief. If you have a long comment, I would suggest you do not present it here. You can send it through email or something like that. Thank you.
I'm Ahmed Bajit Sharkar, Joint Director of Bangladesh Bank. So I'd like to first, I'd like to thank all the presenters for their nice presentation, especially Dr. Mushtaq. We have learned many things from you. My question is to the young professor, Mr. Abdullah, but I'd like to link this question from Dr. Mushtaq. We have the developmental government. So the we can conclude that we can link that developmental trade policy, even the developmental central banking. So Abdullah made some comments by using rigorous econometrics exercises, that if trade GDP ratio is high, then volatility may be the high. But you use some use the data from mostly developing country who mostly follow the developmental trade policy or developmental governments. So in case of Bangladesh, we just promote our export import. So then I think you should think about it. This is not in the simplest way that you say that this is the link with that. Even if you get the result from your econometrics analysis, so you have to think about many things, because we central bank do a lot to promote our trade, and by this way we have achieved. So many things, many econometrics indicators are related to better. And another suggestion, so if you think that...
If you can ask questions, because if you are giving suggestions on paper, you can send it by email or something like that.
Thank you.
So only questions, please, because we don't have time for comments on or suggestions for the paper. Thank you. Yes, who... Please, thank you.
Thank you very much. This is Maruf again, from the Department of Development Studies, Dhaka University. So congratulations to all authors. I really enjoyed the presentations. They're really wonderful work. My question is about the first paper, Professor Mushtaq's paper, and it was a fascinating paper, and I didn't have the chance to read, so I'll be really looking forward to read it in more detail, so that we can really get the overall idea of what you wanted to present. However, if I can take a few of the notes from the very last presentation, Mr. Khaleque's presentation, that he showed us the forecast, and if we take that forecast is going to be something realistic, then we can imagine that Bangladesh is going to stay in group two for maybe for more than a decade or so, or at least two decades. Well, I mean, be optimistic. So, but still, the very question remains important, the one you raised, like the developmental governance question, and the very indicator about the main argument was, if I don't get you wrong, that the creation of a strong agency that can enforce rules legitimately. So my question is about that very indicator that, well, I mean, given the current political settlement, the elites, they reached to some kind of equilibrium that and they created a kind of settlement. So since this creation of a strong agency is a kind of outcome of political settlement, certain kind of political settlement, then how can you really expect to bring changes in the current political settlement that they will create, or the elites will have some kind of incentive to create that sort of a strong agency? Thank you very much.
So as you may know that we are streaming live on YouTube our whole session. So there were some questions from the abroad, and Mr. Mukdo Mahasab, a PhD student, University of Virginia, he has a question to Professor Mushtaq. He asked, the theory of political settlement is somehow disowning a good number of strong empirical results on the causal relationship of institutions on economic growth, that is Assumugli and others who are arguing. Would you like to, he wants to know the point of view from Professor Khan's. How would you, Professor Khan's would take on that? And there is another question to from Syed Hilaluddin, Florida International University PhD student. He has a question to SM Abdullah. He asked, have you checked how is the martial learner condition in your paper?
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. My name is Ratul. I used to work as a research associate at SANEM under Dr. Ryan. My question is to Dr. Mushtaq actually. I was opportune to work on a paper which involved political economic analysis, I mean political theory analysis actually, which particularly was based on deal space. So my question is that as you have talked about, you know, like the settlements in politics, political settlements, so is there any relationship in the formation of deal space? As far as I can recall, it was mostly open deal in our country, I mean, in most cases, because the bottom line was money can do anything. So, I mean, is there any possible reformation of the deal space? Is there any possibility of that which can lead to, you know, like a better chance of sustainability for us to be in the converging developing group? And my second question would be, as you've told that looking at the data, it's a bit indeterminate that where to do or what, I mean, to point finger that where to actually look for acceleration to a higher growth path. So my question would be, like, what is in your opinion the first place to look for a bureaucrat to pursue a certain method of forwarding his or her affairs so that it might contribute to attaining an accelerated growth path? Yeah, thank you.
From ICE Business Times. My question is regarding inflation. So inflation shows economic growth, but do you think Bangladesh is stable in this concern, or are we reaching a point of hyperinflation? Like, where do you think we stand at this point?
Hello, I'm Sandeep from Punjab, India. My question to Dr. Mushtaq, it's a very good paper, sir. I just want to ask that when we are talking about the inclusive growth, you are speaking about from when we come back into first stage, how long a country can put into that condition? It is not necessary that especially if we will look for Asian tigers. I think Korea hasn't come back into the previous condition. So that means time gap also matters. That I want to ask.
Okay, I think we will stop here and give the paper presenters some time. More than 2 minutes, I think 2 minutes will not do justice. First, to Professor Mushtaq, because I think
including from, I think, USA. We welcome, by the way, the those who have joined in long distance YouTube. I think there were a range of questions. You can take them all together. One had to do with the development, governance, creation of strong regions, and how to do that, the theory of political settlement, the question was there. There was another space on deep space formation, and there was a final question of how to accelerate growth in this political environment.
Thank you. There are lots of questions, and I think we should have a longer session sometime, because I can't really answer these questions in a short period. I think the first question was, and the questioner has left actually, so maybe I won't deal with that question. On the question of agencies, political settlements, and so on, this is an extremely important question, right? And I think the problem is this, that the design of policy and the design of what the agency can do has to fit the distribution of organizational power in society, which is the political settlement, right? So a lot of problems happen because we imitate the agency structure or the policy structure of a country which has a different distribution of organizational power, and then we find it is actually a disaster, because the rents that those agencies and policies are creating are captured by powerful organizations which are powerful in this country but were not powerful in some other country. So the question is an iterative one, right? Sometimes the solution could be you can get an improvement in outcomes by designing the policy and the agency structure to take into account the possibility of capture given the political settlement. Okay? But sometimes your political settlement might be so bad that there is nothing you can do which will improve the outcome, in which case you have to ask yourself the much more difficult question, that can the distribution of organizational power be reconfigured through agency, but that's a different kind of agency, right? That is the agency of actually organizing politics, organizing interest groups, organizing business associations, organizing workers' organizations to change the distribution of power that makes certain kinds of things then more feasible, right? Now, as policymakers, I am much more comfortable talking about the first, which is take the political settlement as given and see what you can do with it, because the second is really the task of political entrepreneurs, and the outcome of that is very uncertain usually, right? However, we might be in a situation where the first is highly constrained in terms of what you can do, because the configuration of power is very unsatisfactory for the implementation of policy. That's a really important discussion which will take a long time to go into. But I'm just raising that you have raised actually the critical question there about political settlements. On Acemoglu Robinson and their approach to inclusive institutions and the political settlement approach, I think we disagree fundamentally on their analysis of what are inclusive institutions and inclusive political and inclusive economic institutions. I have written a paper on this, which is published in a book edited by Joe Stiglitz and others, which is on my website. So I would recommend the questioner from the US to have a look at it. The paper is called Governance and Growth, History, Ideology, and Methods of Proof. And I basically question the whole historical interpretation that Acemoglu and Robinson give, looking at colonial history, where they assume that white settler colonies set up stable property rights, and they completely ignore the enormously destructive process through which they destroyed pre-existing societies and right structures as a completely trivial part of the story. The construction of what we describe as inclusive property rights, which is good governance, is always based on the destruction of something which was there prior, right? And they completely ignore the destruction of the prior because it happened very quickly, whereas what is happening in the normal developing countries is that transformation is happening in a protracted period of time, and this transition therefore is very ugly, and it doesn't have the characteristics of good governance. Obviously, once you make that change and you have completely changed your property rights structure, it looks like good governance, but they have missed out the whole transition story by picking precisely those colonial experiences where the transition happened very ruthlessly, almost genocidally, and happened very rapidly, And then you say they set up good property rights. Well, of course they did. But at what cost? This is not a strategy that anyone can imitate. And the whole interpretation of history that they give in the examples in their big fat book on Botswana and others, highly questionable. To argue that Botswana has good governance and stable property rights, Botswana is a one diamond mine company country with less than 2 million people. It's not a model for anybody, and it's not developing the kinds of capabilities and broad-based growth that I would argue, is essential for establishing good governance. So I have serious problem with the Acemoglu Johnson Robinson approach. I have written about it. It's on my website. People can go and look at it. The third question is on deal space. Very good question. There are different approaches to political settlements analysis. I don't agree with the deal space approach. Okay, so this is Kunal Sen, Esid, and people who are developing that. My own feeling is this is a dead end, because their reading of the deal space is based on a very simplistic analysis of rents. I have a book on rents and rent seeking where I have a different approach to rents. The issue is not that you have, at early stages of development, you have rents, and then at later stages of development, you open up and you have an open deal space and no rents. This is a very simplified view of history. If you look at advanced countries like the United States, like the UK, like European Union, they are full of rents. And the issue is how you manage the rents. It's not an open economy with no rents. And this is also my disagreement with Douglas North's limited access order. I collaborate with Douglas North a lot. I have a paper in his book where I take a different position from Douglas North. I agree with Douglas North in the limited access order that developing countries have lots of rents. Where I disagree with Douglas North is that advanced country also has lots of rents, right? And they kind of assume that the more advanced you get, the more open your economy becomes, the less rents you have. Actually, that's absolutely factually untrue. So what we are really talking about is different methods of rent management. And in underdeveloped countries, the rent management has to happen through informal processes, whereas in advanced countries, the rent management happens through formal processes. That's the fundamental difference. So I think the deal space approach really gets it wrong. And so they're looking for how you transit from closed and disordered to open and ordered. I think this is a misunderstanding of the whole political settlements approach, but we can have that discussion again in more detail later on. I have this argument with Gunal Sen and others in ESID all the time. There was finally a question on how do bureaucrats determine what is a good growth path. I think I've already answered that question. This is an iterative point, right? Bureaucrats themselves cannot determine this. Actually, you know, a lot of the good developmental governance approaches emerged through accident. It wasn't through a preconceived plan that this is what is going to work. In fact, what works has to be evolved through experimentation. A policymaker can't tell you this is what's going to work in your country. We can limit the space. We can say, on the basis of previous experience in Bangladesh and what kinds of powerful organizations we have and how they capture rents, these kinds of policies are most unlikely to be well-managed rents, right? So we can limit the space of danger. But we can't say precisely what will work. So evolving the good policies is also an experimental approach. It's an evolutionary approach. We have to try lots of things. There will be failures. You will discover things about your power structure. The critical thing about successful countries is that they tried many things, and the things that didn't work, they dropped. So if you look at China, there was a lot of experimentation. Different provinces tried different things, and then the ones that worked, they replicated. If you look at South Korea, they had big failures in their economic policy. They dropped it. That requires a political settlement. It requires a leadership which is able to extract rents when it doesn't work. And if your political settlement is such that rents get captured very easily, then your experimentation has to be much more modest, it has to be much more small scale, and you mustn't take big risks. Because if you try big things in a country like Bangladesh, the cost of failure is very high. So I would suggest many small experiments and sector-wise approaches, trying to see what works and improving things like, you know, I would say we need a policy on the electronics industry. Let's try different ways of supporting new electronics industry development. We need different kinds of strategies. And then that competition between policies maybe is something that we can work with. I could go on and on, but I will stop on this point.
I think this is, again, as I said, a fascinating subject which can absorb us a lot, and we have the unfortunate situation of not having radio paper or your previous works. I think a better informed debate where we are much more familiar with what Professor Mushtaq is, the messages that he's conveying. Some of the messages are very clear, but I think a better understanding and then we have a informed discussion will be very helpful. Let me now turn to, I think there were several questions on inflation, exchange rate. Let me turn to, you know, the inflation issue. I think Bishnu, Shash, I think there were two, at least one question that I could recognize, hyperinflation, but there were also some methodological issues that Manzoor had raised. So,
I have another author of this paper. He will reply it properly. Please.
The question is hyperinflation. Bangladesh inflation is now moderate. So we have done our study to look at the highest level inflation to identify where our economic growth affects negatively by the inflation. This is our main objective. And the methodology we use simple, just we want to identify the relationship between inflation and growth, the threshold level. So we don't consider other other model, or we do not include other variables. So we can do other study, including other variables in the growth model.
Basically, what you're saying is there is no risk of hyperinflation in Bangladesh, at least at the present time. Is that right?
No. Our inflation is not hyper, but it's moderate.
Yeah, moderate. That's what. Okay, that's the message. Okay. Exchange rate. There was a specific question on the Marshall Learner condition, but I think it's a broader issue about the methodology of how the exchange rate affects growth.
Yeah. Thank you. I hope, first of all, thanks for the valuable comments. I hope that incorporating all those comments will take the paper to a rich level. I would just like to clarify some of the methodological issues first. There was a question about why these 8 countries. I was confined about the way the variable was defined. The main variable was log of volatility. And to extract the log of volatility, I would actually recall high frequency data. And for that high frequency data, I used monthly observation of nominal exchange rate and also monthly observation of consumer price index. So there was some kind of data scarcity. That's why I have to focus only on the 8 countries. And regarding the model specification, of course I'm saying I'm just trying to find the impact of exchange rate volatility and its interactive effect with trade on GDP growth rate. But I didn't forget the other variables. I would like to mention here that I have controlled gross fixed capital formation, which was used as a substitute of investment. I have used employment growth as an exogenous variable, which was used as a labor force substitution. And also I have tried to control the inflation. So the main model was actually consists of 5 variables. One is investment, which is GFCF, gross fixed capital formation. One is employment growth, other one is inflation. And the most two focused variable was actually log of volatility and interaction term. Regarding research question, of course, I do admit that storyboarding it with the research question and the conclusion will make the paper more interesting, definitely. And regarding Marshall Learner condition, the data with which I am actually working and also the issues with which I am working, I haven't actually found that much paper who have really inclined with the testing of Marshall Learner condition. That's why I actually didn't go through the Marshall Learner condition, but I do believe that, of course, incorporating that condition could improve the paper a bit. So with these few words, I think I would like to conclude here. Thank you very much.
So much. I think the final comment that had to do with the Monzur raised the point about the growth. The last paper by Abdul Khaleque about saying that this is exercise in statistics rather than economics. There's no economics in that. Can you refer? Can you respond to that?
You'll see my presentations was basically from the competition part. That is true, but what we are searching, the numbers, so why, when we'll reach, when we'll achieve the middle income country. Actually, whether the economy is running on the right way or not. And I have mentioned lucidly that the limitations of my paper, because this is not my idea failure, rather that is the failure of data deficiency. If you see Mr. Biswas and others, and if you look at the macroeconomic analysis, most of the analysis is basically based on bivariate analysis. And if we don't have enough chance to incorporate a lot of macroeconomic variables in the same framework, because the economic data of Bangladesh is not too much rich. And you see, we have just annual data, so we cannot control the seasonality and irregular variabilities. And we cannot incorporate more than two or three variables. So if there is no lot of scope to incorporate the others' macroeconomic dynamics in the model, this is really difficult for us to give a concrete predictions. I actually agree with you, but we don't have nothing to do. So thank you very much. If you have actually a set of observations, at least a panel data and others, we could do it. So in future, I would revise this paper, no problem. So thank you very much for your comments.
Thank you. I think we have now reached a stage where we close this discussion session and move to the next item. The next item is to invite Paksha Paul, our Chief Economist of the Bangladesh Bank, to share his observations.
Thank you, Dr. Sadiq Ahmed. There are four papers, so but I will just, I'm not a discussant, so it's not that any previous study, but I have some observations, particularly since I work at the central bank. My main interest is in growth and inflation relationship, because we need to find something. So the question is there any threshold? And there are some studies that found different kinds of thresholds, ranging from 8% to 5.5%. So it's really a matter of confusion. And in inflation, only 1 percentage point change in inflation can affect the economy by a large amount. Okay, because you know, just 1% increase in inflation can affect our 100 million consumer in a big way. So that's, it's not that it will have a huge range. So when you see the huge range, there is a problem. So problem is that actually, if you see, if you just as it is, don't go by my advice to Mr. Bishwajit, we should not always go by the data econometrics. First, intuition, observation, checking. So if we check overall, if we see the main picture from 1971 to the last, to the recent time, there is no correlation. It's a very much zigzag data, no correlation. So entire relationship is zero. If you look segment by segment, if you look 70s and 80s, the relationship is negative. Growth is rising, inflation is falling, and it makes sense because there are some occasions. But if you look from 1991, from 90s, 20s, and 2002s, the relationship is positive. So the emergence of the Phillips curve. Now, if you add all of them, you must be confused, and you don't need to add them. Particularly 70s, you have to exclude 70s. 70s inflation data is highly plagued by supply shocks. And fuel shocks, two major shocks. Even in US data, sometimes we see US inflation study, and the study that will decide your policy making must avoid 70s. What about 80s? 80s in US is okay, in other countries okay, but our country went through massive structural changes, structural reform, and so many things happened. So why don't we exclude 80s? if you start liberalization, that started to some extent evidently from the early 90s, and if you start from early 90s, probably you will find a different threshold. And this makes sense in a way that there are policy-wise segmentation of econometric study is needed. When I do econometric study, when I choose the sample, it's just not the choose the sample how much data is available. Sometimes data may not be available, but sometimes the data is hugely available, you have to choose by choice. That happened also in the US economy. US previously just settled on a point that US unemployment rate, natural rate, is around 5% or something like that. But later on, Mankiw came with that, so no, this is not the natural rate. Natural rate can change over time and shock, so it could be around 6.5%. So if that happened, you will have phase-wise inflation threshold for which is good for our growth. So if you take the early 90s and maybe early 90s, since early 90s, your threshold will be much lower. Because once upon a time we thought that in 70s, 80s, what is 10% inflation is good, tolerable, huge inflation in the range of 25% inflation. Now we settle to around 5% inflation is good. In Indian Reserve Bank of India, it says that is 5% it will settle. So it will change. It depends on tolerable, how much tolerable you are. In the US, you know that after 1982, when we had the Volcker disinflation, now inflation in the US has entered in the very low inflation range, and it says their target is 2%. That was not the case 40 years ago. So this is something phase-wise, since you have data frequency is very high, you can do that phase-wise detection of data. And if you come to the paper, which is governance, this is not my area at that point, but to me, there are some called moral hazards issue, it should be added. The way I believe that governance, if we even don't find any causality between governance and growth, but if you look at history, I would say that governance has to start from some point to regulate growth. If you look at the history of Singapore, it's not that Singapore became rich and then looked after governance. From the very first day, they addressed the issue of governance. If you look at the ease of doing business, which is number one in Hong Kong, how did they address the issue of governance? And there are some papers in literature, one paper is quotes, even the governance can vary from British colony and French colony, and how did they make different types of development. And one example in our just cell phone industry, look at cell phone industry, it started with some kind of regulation. And recently, government is very much taking some regulation, and recently the number of cell phones have dropped because there have been some illegal subscribers. But that will give, if a good governance is there, cell phone will even pick up. So it's just, governance is something to me, is sometimes it is coming side by side and we fail to understand the causality, but I would say it is the precursor of our development and growth. This is my opinion because I don't do the deal. After that, exchange rate volatility, Dr. Monzur has done enough, but my question is why the range is 85 to 2030. Different countries you have taken in your sample, and different countries have different regime change. For example, in Bangladesh, I would go for 2003 when we started our volatility. Before that, if you regulate your exchange rate to in a far faster way, then you are not likely to get the real relationship between two variables if you really control one variable very much. So different countries experience different regimes, and that should be taken into consideration, and piece by piece understanding could help your panel data result at the end. And so if flexibility is not allowed, if the result is that there should high flexibility is bad, well, when we enter into the regime of market-based floating rate, flexibility will be higher than a fixed rate. But what is the moral implication of this? Implication is that should we go for fixed? And if we go for fixed, what will happen if, like as told by Don Bush, it could cause overshooting and cause huge collapse. So to me, my moral persuasion is I will go for market-based because that is safe, and that will keep me regardless which growth we are getting.
The last paper is forecasting. It is interesting because now we all are looking at 2021. There are four types of forecasting, and actually I would say from now on, if you do any kind of forecasting, you should combine all of them and get the numbers and come for a middle point or some kind of adjustment. One is the reduced form equation, another is sector-wise estimation, another is investment sector-wise estimation and reduced form. In Bangladesh Bank we do both. But like our planning, what actually Dr. Sadiq Ahmed was involved, it goes with the investment GDP ratio, and then they divide it with incremental capital output ratio. That is okay to some extent, but not always okay, because incremental capital output ratio will change over time. And the final one is comprehensive system model, because where you cannot gather all the variables like sentiment, public sentiment, so political stability, infrastructure index, how it is growing, all these factors will not come into a reduced form. So that's the point, that you should do a little bit comprehensive study. Otherwise, the numbers you are getting may be plagued by the upward trend and trend biased rate, because as you notice that it's upward trend. And if you notice, if you go by fixed trend, then you will be also confused. You have to go by changing trend, like HP filter. If you look at HP filter, our trend has slowed, and you're right, but the trend value is 6.27. But on top of that, HP filter could be the floor of a potential growth for a developing economy, because in a developing economy, there is a floor and there is a ceiling. But for the developed economy, since the economy is mature, the band is narrower. But for the developing economy, if you correct our traffic system, if you correct our Potta bridge, if you speed up our judiciary, our potential growth could be much higher. So the range is huge. But in a developed economy where everything is mature, there the floor and ceiling, there is a little gap. So I would suggest that check whether your forecasting is affected by the trend, positive trend, the value is whether affecting or not. Other than that, the papers were very much interesting, and also I agree with that. The question of Dr. Monzur, that why it is again, to justify that you need justify that threshold again, if you go with different sample, if you go with variable sample, different regime change. And always my request to my colleagues and some of your senior, that what lesson I got from my supervisor, he said, don't just go by data, go by policy changes. That makes sense. So if you do study on India, go by when India embarked on liberalization. Don't mix this data with previous data, then you might get with some confusing results. So watch for policy changes and then segment your data accordingly. Thank you very much for giving me a chance, and thank you for inviting me.
Thank you, Biru, for your very thoughtful and perceptive observations. I think we're coming to a stage where we'll close this session in another 5 to 10 minutes. Let me very quickly offer a few thoughts. First of all, I think I would like to congratulate all the authors for really sharing with us a very rich and diverse set of papers and work in progress, if I can say so. From my personal perspective, I particularly was fascinated by the presentation that Professor Khan made. I think this is an area which really requires a lot of understanding and engagement in Bangladesh, including with the political process. I think this will serve Bangladesh a lot, and I have invited Professor Khan to think about making his analysis and research available for wider political dissemination, including policymakers. And we from the PRI, we have access to the government. We can help that process should he be so willing. Because I think this is a rich set of discussion, and there are also alternative. There are lots of ideas which are contestable. And for that, I don't think we can have engagement in this kind of a forum, because you've not read the paper, you've not done our research. Lots of issues will come up. Hossain, Zillur, Rahman made some very interesting points about the independence of the political, of the, what you call it, the two, you made two points about two approaches that you said, whether they are independent from the political environment.
or not? I think the development governance was rules-based, and can they be independently done of the political system? So anyway, I think that set of discussion really requires thoughtful focus and well, I would say, well-researched discussion. It can't be done off the cuff, journalistic kind of responses. So I'll avoid making too many comments on that at the risk of not being able to understand fully your messages and conveying my own views on that. But I think that was excellent and it's needed for Bangladesh as we embark on this 7 to 8% growth rate, lower middle income, aspiring to be a higher middle income, and then there is a talk about becoming higher income country by 2041. That's one of the fastest transition, if I may say so, looking at the data. Now there are lots of implications for organizations, for institutions, for political arrangements, for policies, etc. And the heart of one of the, I would say, core element of that is governance and the political system. So I think we leave that for the later. On the other three papers, I think Manzoor gave some very, nice advice, and so did Biru to the researchers. I welcome their enthusiasm and the need for doing that research. But I will also join Professor Khan in giving a word of caution, which is that given these days of computer, easy access to computer models and databases internationally, the temptation of running sophisticated statistical methods to try to get a result is very tempting, and I've seen quite a bit of that. The first question is, as Manzoor and Biru both had emphasized, go back to the fundamentals, go to the economics. What are you trying to explain? Understand that. Develop the hypothesis, understand the interrelationships, and then see if you can fit it to a data, rather than having a data and then trying to explain that result. That's my personal view. I'm sure there are other approaches to that problem. Because, for example, when I look at, unless I know the economics, then what I'm trying to explain, what does exchange rate volatility means, how is it defined? And what is it affecting, for example? That's a set of questions Manzoor had also raised. But I'll come to one where we are having an active policy debate. And there, from the Policy Research Institute, I happen to sit in the Bangladesh board also, but I also represent an institution which is the Policy Research Institute. And at PRI, we seem to have a slightly different view from the Bangladesh Bank on this whole issue of inflation. So when I get a 6.5% threshold, I worry a lot about that. Because we have been advising Bangladesh Bank that 6.5% inflation in today's global world is very high. It has a lot of problems because it affects the exchange rate management, which has been appreciating tremendously in the last few years, and it's not a sustainable exchange rate to have this high rate of real appreciation. It has other effects. And I would like to empirically question the judgment that in order to get 8% growth rate, I need 6.5% inflation. I do not know. Why? Because the global environment is also a variable in that decision. In today's, and I just very quickly looked at the data set from 1981 to 2014. That's a 34 years of data of sustained growth rates of countries which have sustained for 33 years, 5% or more. So this is not a fluke of 5 years and then you go down. And guess what? The highest growth, of course, we all know is China. Almost 10%. And guess what? It has the lowest rate of inflation. Average inflation was only 3.2. The highest rate of inflation in that group was Indonesia, 10%. Its growth rate was 5%. I do not know. I mean, it may vary, as Biru said, different phases of life. But long-term relationship is what is important. Do I aim for a sustained rate of growth and a sustained rate of, what do you call it, stability? And short-term fluctuations will happen for a variety of reasons, because global oil prices will go up. There will be a food shock. The climate change can happen, and it can have a severe flooding. Rice price will go down. So there will be fluctuations. That's understandable. We're not worrying about that. But the long-term pattern, what should be? People base their expectations that way. Investors invest on that way. Is this a highly inflating country? Is it a stable country? Lots of issues are there. So I think on the Bangladesh Bank, which is the keeper of the gates on inflation, they really have to think through that very carefully before we set parameters and justify the 6% plus inflation target in the monetary policy or in the government's policy. I think that's one area where we need to have a little more understanding. I think the main message that is coming out is that there is Bangladesh is at a stage where it has earned, I would say, international attention for a lot of development achievements on the growth rate. It's fundamentally the rate of return of good policies, as I say, despite all the limitations, has been clear. It has a steady growth rate, and for 30 plus years it has achieved an average growth rate of 5%, which I think needs to be, should be celebrated. More recently growth has accelerated. There is a need for going to 7 to 8%. That's the government's definition. Some people would say, what is wrong with the 6% growth rate? I think 6% growth rate, sustained growth rate, is very good by historical standard, by international standards. So nothing wrong with that. But since the government wants to move forward, so be it. It has the potential. The question is, what sets of policies and institutions will allow that? It is not independent of policies. It's not a arithmetic moving average of past growth rates. That's not the case. Otherwise, we'll get a 9% growth doing nothing. Suppose the whole country is under flood or there is a natural disaster. Will we still get a 9% growth rate or 8% growth rate because there is no investment? You know, the last 4 years, the investment rate has been stagnant. There's a lot of capital flight, as Professor Mushtaq has very rightly pointed out. Private investment is, not responding despite the semblance of political stability, but at the same time there's a political uncertainty. So lots of questions that come to mind. There's no guarantee that the growth rate that you have today will be repeated in the next 10 years just because it has grown in the past. So I think the whole issue is to find out the set of policies, institutions that will allow us, and even the external environment, allow us to go there. That's the debate. That's where I think a lot of fascinating analysis has come up, and there are some people who are skeptical that, with this present level of what you call a political maturity and institutions, going to the 8% growth rate is not a practical or feasible option. Now, that is an assumption which has to be tested and discussed, and that's where I find Professor Khan's analysis very helpful, because remember the same set of objectives was set for the 6th plan. The 6th plan said they want to go to 8% growth rate. What did they get? We got 6%. We didn't get the 8%. Why? And there are lots of questions to that. The investment rate didn't come. Why didn't it come? The macro stability is there. So I think those questions will have to be, in some sense, looked at. But growth is not independent of policies and institutions. I mean, even though, there are models that would like to think so, but I think the general presumption is it responds to certain, even if you do growth accounting, it responds to capital accumulation and accumulation of labor force and technological progress, etc. But then you bring in the role of institutions and private sector and behavior and global uncertainties and for international competition, etc. It will get a lot more complicated. So I think the main message is that there's a lot of work to be done, and particularly the area of political economy, which is something that is not well understood in Bangladesh, is not well researched, and there is not a proper dialogue between the policy makers and the people who understand that, and that's the vacuum that we have to fill. Because in other areas, there's a lot of work that is being done by local institutions, even with the Ministry of Finance. Ministry of Finance has developed quite a bit, because I go and give them lectures every week there, and I think they do have a capacity developing up in terms of the growth projections on macro modeling. They have their own model and planning commissions. So that those things are developing. What is lacking is understanding of how policies are made, what are the trade-offs, behavior of private investors, rent seekers, all kinds of things. So the political economy issue is not well understood, and that's a gap that I think we can all, if we can help make that, in addition to the research that we're doing on role of interest rate, exchange rate, fiscal policy, monetary policy, inflation, etc., which are some of it were discussed today. I think the missing link is really the understanding and research on institutions and governance. And that's where, if this forum can make a contribution, I think it will take Bangladesh to the next stages. With that, I will close and thank you all for your participation. I think we were efficient. We did right on time. Now there is a small presentation, right, on the CRES. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. I would like to request the chair to hand over the CRES to Dr. Biru Paksha Pal. Now to Dr. Monzur Hossain. Now I would like to request the chair to hand over the CRES to all the presenters. At first, Professor Mushtaq Khan. and Mr. Bishnu for the Vishash. Mr. S.M. Abdullah, next. And then Mr. Muhammad Abdul Khaleque. Now I would like to request Dr. Saima Haq Bidisha to hand over the crest to our Honorable Chair. I would request all the co-authors to collect their crest from the registration desk. And now we will go for lunch. And after lunch, we have a session, we have our book launching ceremony, and that will start sharp at 2:40. So we have 40 minutes for lunch. Thank you.